Christian says that you've got some special thing planned.
Yeah, it's like a crazy 9-day festival. It only happens every 90 years.
Hi. Hello. Theodore. You can't speak. You can't move. But this opens you up to the influence. And it breaks down your defenses. Trust me. All right?
On this, the day of our deity in reciprocity, we gather to give special thanks to our treasured podcast listeners. As an offering during this, the spookiest of all seasons, we will today surrender 3 human lives who will be joining me to discuss the 2019 Ari Aster romantic comedy, Midsommar. And as I said, there are others amongst us. But first, before I get to that, let me say to everyone, skål! As I christen spooky season with a pumpkin beer. Now on to my co-host. First up is a new blood, a brand new member of our community, a young man who has honored us for his unclouded intuition. He is part of the podcasting royal family as he makes his debut on Fine Movies, Fine Spirits. His mother, Christine, is a previous guest of the show, and his father, Brian, he listens sometimes, so that's something.
He's mentioned
more than almost anybody. Young Jack, welcome to the show. How are you doing? What are you drinking this evening? And most importantly, who is your favorite member of the show and why is it me?
I'm doing great this evening. This evening, I am drinking Hennessy Pure White. I was gifted this by a cousin of mine who knows I enjoy Hennessy by the name of Anthony Pirelli. So shout out to him. Apparently, you can only get it in France. That is what I'm drinking. And I would have to say my favorite... Yep, I would have to say my favorite member of the show is probably Christopher Morris because I've known him the longest.
That's
not that. What a fucking pussy move that is.
We've all known him the longest. That doesn't mean anything.
You're supposed to suck up to your dad's friends. Thank you, Jack. Okay.
Next up is that's fine. Dave usually interrupts. Next up is a man who, when he found out this was a movie featuring a young man inside a bear, he got all hot and bothered until he found out it was an actual bear. My good buddy David, how are you doing? And what are you drinking? And is it another Manhattan 2 nights in a row?
No, that was not a Manhattan. It was a fucking cause. It was a cause of no. No, was it a Manhattan? Yeah,
it was a Manhattan.
Yeah, it was.
A really good Manhattan. It was air infused with sage. Oh my god! So
what are you drinking now, dummy?
I'm drinking a Swedish wine.
Ooh,
excellent!
I don't know the name of it, but it's Swedish. It's
definitely not.
Now, when it was sweet, was it Swedish? The good. Moment?
No, it's. It's refined from the mountains of Sweden.
Asti Spumanti.
That's going to be as believable as my drink.
And yes, you're here finally joining us as always. Shut up, Dave. What can I say? We view life as a circle, a recycle. Now that we have a young man, a young voice on the show, it might be time to take a look at our oldest host and try to have him forego a life of pain and fear and shame and give his life as a gesture before it can spoil. But until then, he's still here. Mr. Christopher Morris, how are you doing this evening? Jack's favorite. What are you drinking? Not that I'm bitter.
Doing well, Michael. Thank you. I am drinking a hallucinogenic tea. It's actually just a hot toddy with lemon you know, a fresh pube and a little bourbon in there.
Now,
just clearing up the cold. Yes.
I was going to have a mushroom tonight, and I decided against it because I've never had one.
Dave, you didn't start drinking early, right? Because we're supposed to all.
I did drink early.
I'll be so pissed if we're not going in the same time. We're not tripping in the same time.
Now, I obviously know what a hot toddy is, but why don't you explain that to everyone else at home? I'm drinking, how about this? I'm drinking a pumpkin beer that has been in my fridge since we did Rosemary's Baby. We'll see if it's any good. I don't know.
That is excellent. Mike, it's just a little lemon and some hot water and bourbon, actually. But I'm excited for this. I want to hear Jack's take on Ari Aster and this movie, obviously. Was very excited when your dad said you were a fan. Assume he and your mom have not seen any of these movies.
So I actually think they have seen Hereditary now, but I'm not sure. Yeah, yep. I'm not sure if they've seen Midsommar. Their feedback on that was a little bit mixed, but I kind of found this director in college, and that was kind of how I really got into him. I've seen both Hereditary and Midsommar countless times, but I honestly have to say that I probably like Midsommar better than the two.
I like Human Centipede the best. I think his work in that one.
I'm not sure. I'm not entirely sure. Are you familiar with Human Centipede, Jack?
I'm familiar with it. I think that's more of a fetish film than a horror movie. Yeah. But hey, you know, to each their own.
I'm more into the sequels.
It's like the unofficial.
You haven't seen that, have you?
I have not seen that, and I think I could probably go through my life being content with not seeing that.
I don't think any of us.
Yep, I think that's the same as all of us.
I've seen it.
You've seen Human Centipede? No, you haven't.
Yes, I have seen Human Centipede.
Okay, look at his face.
Hold on. Really quick, I'm very excited about Halloween, and I'm excited that you guys think this is the first Halloween episode, which is fucking not, obviously. The last one was the kickoff to the Halloween season. But I'm very proud that my granddaughter has watched not only Salem's Lot with me.
Midsommar? I hope not.
No, she just watched a little bit of Midsommar. I had a cool watch and the person jumped off the fucking cliff. But she was trying to pull my hand down so she could see it. But she's a badass like my daughter. She's only two. And she loves this shit.
I saw what she was watching yesterday.
Shout out to me for being a badass. She's a much bigger badass than Mikey. What?
I saw Emily shared a picture. She was watching The Omen yesterday. You just her sitting in front of the TV watching The Omen.
She loved it.
Jack, what you don't know is Dave showed his daughter Emily The Exorcist when she was nine. And
we talked about that. Yeah,
played it tough.
Very inappropriate, amazingly inappropriate.
Definitely scarred her for weeks, if not years.
I thought she was...
I mean... Hey, I was thrilled when my parents said I could play GoldenEye at nine. So, you know, I was psyched to be able to see and play that at 9 years old. So, yeah. Wow, The Exorcist, that's hardcore for 9 years old. That's punk.
It was dumb. It's hardcore for 19.
Yeah, I think that's when I first saw that movie. Yep.
But, yes, listen, I this is my favorite time of year. I love this movie. I didn't think I actually freaked me the fuck out so much that I had to watch Hubie Halloween right after this.
Need a little Hubie to take the edge off.
Fucking crazy. I don't want to get into the whole thing. I don't want to spoil for anyone here, but like, it was in my mind, it was definitely a very artsy movie. It's a very artsy movie, really.
Well,
attention.
We'll get into, but it's so well done.
Is it more beautifully shot?
Yep.
I was like,
is it horrific? I don't think it's
horrific than horror because it's mostly just uncomfortable.
Ari Aster called it, you know, horror adjacent, which he also said it's not up to him to, you know, classify what his movies are. So I saw Hereditary first, loved it, thought it was amazing, and then saw this. I didn't know if I liked it as much the first time I saw it, but with subsequent viewings, I been blown away by this. I think this is the better movie. It is so creepy. Just seeing it's nightmare fairy tale, really.
And a breakup movie. Yeah. He said it's basically a
relationship movie.
Right.
Yeah. Mikey, did you see it just one time again?
This was just I saw it a few years ago, and then this was the second time. I said, this is a great movie. I don't know if I have to watch it again, but I did enjoy, you know, it's just, it is a I don't know if I enjoyed it as much as I appreciate it.
Yeah,
it's tough.
It's not enjoyable.
Jack, did you rewatch it?
Yeah, so I actually rewatched it today, and something that I noticed with a lot of Ari Aster's films is it's not a lot of more like, for example, my parents watched Hereditary the first time, they were like, oh, we didn't think that was that scary, but it's incredibly different than sort of like the horror they grew up with, like Freddy Krueger and Friday the 13th.
Yeah, exactly.
I thought this is a lot more disturbing. It's a lot more of a disturbing film, and a lot of the fear, that is generated in those movies to scare the audience. A lot of that fear generates from like mental health and relationships, which are something in my generation is a way bigger problem, than it used to be now, I feel like. So that's why I get. Yep.
I also think it's more believable. What you see here versus what we saw as kids, those flash movies weren't believable, obviously. This is believable.
And this
somewhere.
Right. And this is unsettling, you would say, as opposed to, something in the dark. I mean, the fact that it takes place in such a beautiful setting and it's all daylight.
Right. Yep.
It just adds to it. But Mike, you want to give us the stats?
Yes, let's run through it. From 2019, Midsommar, written and directed by Ari Aster, starring Florence Pugh, Jack Raynor, Wilhelm Blomgren, William Jackson Harper, Will Poulter, and Mr. Cuddles as Kevin the Bear.
Will Poulter.
I just made that up. I don't know. Yeah, Will Poulter, who is, I remember him from other things. From the Bear. Who cares?
I'm right here.
He's not needed.
Yeah.
I mean, thank God he's still here. It has a Rotten Tomatoes score of 83% with the critics and only a 63% with the audience score. And I totally get it because people are probably freaked out. It has a Metacritic score of 72, a Cinema score of C+. Again, I think just people watching it can say it's not enjoyable or freaked out by it. On a budget of $9 million, it did make money. It made at a $27 million U.S. box office and a worldwide total of $47 million. And that's back in 2019 when the average ticket price was $9.16. It was not nominated for Academy Awards, but it was nominated for a bunch of secondary awards and won some film festival stuff. I mean, it was definitely critically widely loved, acclaimed. That's the word.
Now, our whole Oscar take that we do now, going back to that year, who won the best actress? Because in all seriousness, this performance is not just, great for a horror movie. Again, we didn't establish this isn't like a regular horror movie, but her performance is incredible, I think.
Yeah.
Starting with the cold open, the first 10 minutes, which is some of the most disturbing, shit you'll ever see open up.
By the way, I thought this movie was going to be completely different.
Yeah. Yeah.
In that first 20 minutes.
So who won? Best actress?
Yeah.
Renee Zellweger for Judy. For the
Florence Pugh should have won.
Absolutely,
we'll give her that. I don't think it should have won Best Picture, but
yeah, Best Picture was Parasite. I mean, that was the year of Joker.
Oh, that was a tough year.
Joker, Ford v Ferrari, 1917, Jojo Rabbit, Irishman, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Parasite. I mean, that was killer
Holy
year.
Crap.
Yeah.
Wow.
So,
she was incredible.
Yeah, I don't know who else. Like, I mean, I don't think anyone else would have been even thought of as being nominated besides her.
And by the way, she is a smoke show.
David Hot Alert. Repeat. This is a David Hot Alert. This is not a test.
Nailed it.
Yeah.
So hot.
In those sweatpants.
God, I don't give a shit. Perfect.
So I'm glad you're not, we'll get, I'm going to do the plot, but we'll bang out the plot real quick, but I can't wait to get your take on the naked, ritual.
Didn't like it at all.
You didn't like it? Really?
Mikey's used to it. It was jarring for me, but Mikey grew up on that. You got to remember that.
A lot of pausing. Yeah.
I knew that was coming. I knew it was, it's so weird when Mikey.
It was like watching home movies.
Mel's ass.
Mikey pushed Mel's ass in his vagina, which is really weird, but he enjoyed it.
It's taken a turn. Actually, it hasn't really.
No,
your parents, if your parents actually finally watch this movie,
I don't like, so that's the thing is like, I don't know if they've seen Midsommar, but I think they know of that scene maybe.
Oh, it's
It's just
probably
like every,
jarring.
yeah, like I feel like, and I feel like I've actually, met a lot of people, I talked to a lot of people that know what Midsommar is and haven't seen it, but still know of that scene. I
Really? That's
honestly
funny.
think it
I
was,
didn't.
yeah, it's just like, so it's an extremely controversial scene, and I get it, like honestly, with how disturbing the entire movie is, it's not really something that should be surprising. But every
Exactly.
time
It's
I,
supposed to be weird, right?
yeah,
It's
every
I
time I
mean, this is
watch it,
a
I'm just like,
yep.
is this some sort of,
Has
is this
turned on
some
his
sort of
iron.
maybe underlying fantasy of the director or
Right.
something? But it's just, yeah, it's
Yeah.
that scene, even watching that today, and I've seen it over and over again, I'm like, did we really need this? Like, it's
Yeah,
been
it's wild.
disturbing,
The
but
first
did we
time I
need
saw
this?
it,
Yeah.
yeah.
I think you needed it. I think that was a very
Of course you did,
Yeah.
you whore dog.
As much as no, as much as there was
No,
a
it's part
fucked
of
up
their
scene, it's part of
it's
their
part
culture
of
and their
their
ritual.
ritual.
Yeah.
guess
So
a half hour
if he's going to kill him.
I guess there was a half
What?
hour cut out of this movie. It was supposed to be, it was originally an
Oh yeah,
NC
he
17.
filmed it. It was like 3.5, I think it was like
Yeah.
3.5 hours or something. So
Yeah.
it's funny,
So.
I tease your dad about his being conservative sometimes with his movie. Like he was telling me last night, oh, I just saw Secretariat. No, what movie is it?
Seabiscuit.
Was it Seabiscuit? Seabiscuit.
Seabiscuit.
There's both of them. There's both of them are more are movies, right? There is a movie
Yes.
Secretariat too, but Seabiscuit's the more famous one. But he's like, oh, I saw Seabiscuit, loved it. And I'm like, yeah, So, and I was thinking, this is kind of, if Seabiscuit, if they took the jockey and they disemboweled Seabiscuit and then they put the jockey into
Yeah.
Seabiscuit, that would kind
Same
of be
movie.
like just like Midsommar. Very similar. Very
Yeah.
similar films. They're often compared.
Good. Pause real quick. I'd
Spoilers.
actually, I no, no. I would actually like, I'm going to throw this in the ring. I would like to do Seabiscuit during next year's Kentucky Derby run. Fucking
Okay,
great movie. So
we'll
call
think
out to
about
that one.
that. Yeah,
No, no, what
we'll
do you know?
we'll run
What
that
are you
up the
doing in that
board.
joint?
We'll vote.
Oh,
Yeah.
shut the fuck up, the world you, the board.
We'll put it. Hey, look,
I
you get several movies at your
do?
disposal, don't you? You just
I
got Sixth
think
Sense,
it.
and like
Yeah.
you two, and so and
Where's
One
it?
Crazy
Who's that?
Summer, or I'm sorry, Better Off Dead,
Yeah, I've seen just some fucking good ones.
and Pee-wee. I know they're all good.
I
I agree.
think you're
That's
that
why we do them.
lucky.
That's why we do them.
That's a
That's
good
why
one,
we're.
though.
That's
You
why we allow them.
say a movie, you
I'm gonna
show
bang
up,
out the plot
you
real
talk for
quick.
10 minutes, and then you leave, and you don't do anything. You don't partake at all. You don't even listen.
That's my strength. That's my strength on the show. I bring it. Go ahead. Sorry.
All right. Let me just bang out the plot real quick with my Jimmy Conway glasses. All right. During the winter, American student Danny's traumatized by her mentally ill sister, who ends up killing their parents and herself with carbon monoxide poisoning, causing a strain on the relationship with her boyfriend Christian, who was about to break up with her. Months later, Danny ends up joining her boyfriend and his friends to Sweden for a 9-day midsummer festival at the commune of their Swedish friend Pelle. The festival occurs every 90 years, and their friend Josh is writing his thesis on it. The group meets British couple Simon and Connie, also invited by Pelle's commune brother Ingemar. For a ceremony, the group witnesses its after at a stupor, where two elders commit suicide by jumping off a cliff to the rocks below.
We have Atta Stupid. His name is Dave.
That is stupid. They're pretty good. When one of the elders survives, the members crush his head with a mallet. They take turns, actually. The commune elder tries to calm down the visitors by explaining it's a great honor. It's the end of their journey, which starts, I think winter starts at my age, 54. 54 to 72. Scary. After Christian decides to do his thesis on the commune, Connie and Simon demand to leave and to be driven to the train station. After Mark urinates on a sacred tree, he is lured away by a female member. We also see Josh sneak to take pictures of sacred texts, but is caught and bludgeoned to death by a half-naked man wearing Mark's skin face. The next day, after Danny and Christian are pressured into drinking
hallucinogenic tea. Danny ends up participating in a May Queen dancing competition, which he wins, and Christian is coerced into a sexual ritual to impregnate a young member of the commune.
Coerced.
Way too young. Danny witnesses and has a panic attack. Christian tries to flee naked, discovers Josh's leg and Simon's body before being paralyzed by an elder blowing powder in his face. For the final ceremony, we learn the commune must offer 9 sacrifices, human sacrifices, to purge it of evil. First 4 were outsiders lured by Peli and Ingemar. The next 4 were 2 elders and 2 members who volunteer. The May Queen must choose the last one between a random member and the paralyzed Christian, who she chooses. Christian is stuffed into a disemboweled bear, placed in a wooden temple, and then along with the rest of the sacrifices is burned. Danny watches as the temple burns to the ground and smiles as it collapses. Now,
they told those 2 guys, here, take this so you won't feel anything, but I'm pretty sure they felt it.
Well, they were screwing me.
Yeah, so I read about different things with that.
They did not go out painless. I don't think whatever tincture from the yew tree that they were blessed with really did anything.
Yeah, like, they were kind of full of shit, right? The cult.
Now, the smile at the end, that seems to be very unsettling.
So,
is it to me? I think it's she doesn't. She has a new family.
Yeah,
she has a family.
He's accepted.
She lost her family, and and is, you know, has gone off the reservation too mentally
a little bit. Yeah.
But she has a new family. It's funny because Peli also mentioned he lost his parents. They were burned.
He wanted her bad. Oh yeah, I noticed that they were burned.
So I think they were just part of the ceremony, right? And then, and then burned.
And Marcus, I don't know if I picked up the first time, the skin. It's in the dark.
There's a few things it took a few times.
They were earlier. He must be the fool, Mark, because earlier in the
Skin the Fool,
they were playing Skin the Fool. So. Little foreshadowing for that. The British girl who we never we only see at the end in the wheelbarrow.
You see her
getting wheeled in.
Yep.
That's her screaming, right? Remember that at one point they just hear screaming?
At one point they're just so nonchalant doing their chores and you hear 3 screams. It took me a few times to notice that too.
How do you muffle your victims so they don't scream, Mikey?
Face down.
He gives him the yew tree.
Dave, let me put it this way. You'll find out.
It is the yew tree. It is the yew tree.
The yew tree. Which I guess it's really poisonous, right?
It is. Yeah.
Maggie knows. Good. Sorry.
Which actually, it's funny. Your dad and I went to environmental camp in the 5th grade at Glen Forest, and it was exactly like this movie.
Nerds.
We just don't talk about it.
Yeah. I think I may have heard a tale or two from it, you know?
It was exactly.
Yes. We played Skin the Fool. We played Skin the Fool. And so you mentioned, Skin the Fool.
You cough on your own time.
I got a cough button that I've been hitting. I've been using.
Because I was reading some of the trivia. The Skin the Fool was a little foreshadowing. And then there was a deleted scene where they were trying to drown. They were drowning a kid, and the kid was wearing the same outfit that the body in the wheelchair is wearing at the end. So they're kind of saying that was connection that they probably drowned that girl, the British girl.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
This was just what I'm reading in the trivia. Yeah. Connie. Yep.
So did you notice just little things? Mark was funny. Cause he was kind of like the avatar of the audience.
Yeah.
In a way with his comments saying how, you know, why are they walking so stupid? You know, when
he's
the girls
playing the
are walking
idiot
backwards.
American, pretty much.
And he says,
Mark reminded me of a lot of people I went to school with.
Oh yeah, similar people. He was such a dick, right?
Yeah, it reminds me of like the average, like like your average college. He's walking around, he's hitting his little vape, he's just kind of blowing things off. The only thing he cares about, you know, is who's the hottest chick at the festival, like.
Yeah. And they get a trip at the same time. So he makes a comment. I don't know if you noticed. He's like, so we're stopping here in Waco. We're at Waco, you know, comparing it to, you know, this cult, this cult that we're at. So it's kind of, I mean, plot wise, you don't know exactly what's going to happen, but it's kind of plays out like you assume, right?
Do you think the plan the whole time was to bring her in, or did that just work out? Like, once
you know what's funny, because I
that one the Swedish guy was like really into her and into like, oh, I'm very glad you're coming and all these things. And
so my question is, he befriended these his fellow grad students to get them back, knowing they were going to be a sacrifice, right?
Yes.
Because yeah.
Were they all brought for the sacrifice?
Him credit. Yeah, they gave him credit and the other guy credit. So, I mean, they do things which it's funny because of like the regular horror movie tropes, two teens having sex or they're doing something which causes them to be murdered. And this, you know, Mark, which is funny, he urinates on the ancestral tree, which, you know, it's funny because he's like, that guy's going to kill me. You know, yeah, you're right. You're right, Mark.
The way they're staring at him at dinner.
So Ulf is the guy that he ends up wearing Mark's skin face, and he also ends up burning alive and screaming. So he's the same guy who volunteers. But and then Josh deserved to die in a way, right? By
they all deserve to die. They're all bastards. Everybody's a bastard.
So the more I watched it, the more I
common.
Yeah,
there is like a common theme with the movie. It's
males
like
males being assholes.
I mean. Yeah, it's just everyone there. It's like if you were a dick or you were disrespectful, like, you know, you got killed. I mean, as messed up as Danny was, I mean, she was really kind of the only one. And, you know, I'm not condoning. This isn't, you know, this
no,
isn't.
No, that is definitely the
like, yeah, like a pass for anything that the cult did. But Danny was really the only one there that didn't do anything bad to, you know,
right.
Be disrespectful or screw the halt over. Yeah.
Yeah. She even won the May Queen. But that leads me to ask. I mean, they were there for a sacrifice. Like, what if they didn't do anything? Were they still needed a sacrifice? Were they, you know what I mean? They needed outsiders to be sacrificed.
Yeah, they were going to sacrifice no matter what, obviously. Mm-hmm. So it is what it is.
But I'm just right, happy,
they're,
that's
all,
the movie,
I'm just happy
that
they're all kind of pithy. Who cares? Mm-hmm. It's a fucking movie. I don't condone it either, obviously. Except for Mikey and his family, they condone this stuff. But other than that, look, I don't condone
my family's
any
more
sacrifice.
Open. Yeah, let it be okay. Official. David okay, doesn't so, condone sacrifice. You make it
no,
official.
No, can I just say this though? When those two fucking people walked up on the mountain, I knew they were coming down face first. I knew it. I called
yeah, but
it.
Did you know it was going to be that graphic?
Did I know it was going to be that graphic? Obviously not.
Just right
the
in
first
your face.
One went out. The first one went out peacefully. She probably they probably hit the ground. That was it. Dead. Right? That poor other bastard. How the hell are they still yeah. living?
He did a needle dive.
He landed on his leg.
Oh,
he did a pencil dive. I mean, the other chick had the right idea. She threw herself up. This guy was like, oh, I'm going to go legs. I mean, come on, man. 72 years in a cult and how you're going to go is feet first.
Exactly. Oh. Exactly. And they must teach this.
Yeah. Like, I mean, he must have seen it countless times growing up. He's like, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go feet first. That seems like a good idea.
Exactly.
So I'm sure he's seen other people fail too. So he knew that the end result was going to be I'm going to get my head fucking smashed in like the people were fucking hammers.
Unless
that is disturbing. It looked like a little bit of an homage to The Shining with when Danny is seeing the smashed faces and, you know, she tries to scream and the.
I love how during that whole part too, the audio is like completely muffled as well. Like you have Connie and you have the hell's the other kid's name? I can't remember.
Simon.
Connie and Simon. You have them like completely freaking out.
This is fucked. Fuck this. You're fucked. Fuck. You're the fucking standing there watching. What the fuck is wrong with you? Fuck. No!
Please,
fucking
please!
Leave her alone!
Please listen
what?
To me! Let me explain!
What?
Please, my poor thing.
What?
Please, what you just saw is a long, long, long observed custom.
Custom?
Yes.
It's fucked!
Those two hoodlums has just reached the end of their horga life cycle, and you need to understand it as a great joy for them.
A joy?
Yes, and when it's my turn, it would be a great joy for me.
And
you just
you know,
hear
the
them.
Audio is
it's so great.
Yeah, and the audio is very muffled, and Danny is just deadlocked on him.
Yeah, it's on her face, and you see her. Oh my God! It's and then Christian, barely disturbed. I mean, he's such an asshole. Like I
put this fucking paper on him right after that.
He immediately wants to do his paper on that, and then he's a dick to Josh too when he's just all the time. He's so often a, you know, a selfish asshole.
Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah. I see that happening. I'm running. I'm done. She's in a fucking cult. I'm going to hitch it out of myself. I'm going to run myself, and not one of you fuckers is going to catch me. Well, if you do, I'm going to beat
Mark was mad that he missed it. Mark was mad that he missed it. I loved what he did with the camera also. When it was like rippling when they were tripping.
Yes, all those little effects. Because, I mean, it's $20 million budget. I feel like most of it went to all the set design, because the set design was pretty incredible. All those intricate buildings. But the CGI, just little CGI things with the flowers. Some of it was just for our, you know, what we're seeing. Yep. The tripping, you know, with the... it's just out of the eye line of the stuff on the table rippling and moving. I thought that was very effective.
One time I had way too much chocolate, and I was definitely fucking... I thought I was walking on clouds, so I felt for her. I felt for her bad.
That's a great story, yeah, Dave. What kind of chocolate?
I took a bigger piece of chocolate than I should have.
Like Russell Stover?
No, it was definitely infused with something else. But I legit went from being normal to sweating in a restaurant to now thinking after that I was walking on a cloud and I had someone had actually hold me up. Isn't that crazy?
Well,
so yeah.
You gotta be careful around those Wonka bars, man.
Yeah.
I felt for her in that moment because she was definitely freaking
out.
She's
a young woman in her 20s experimenting. You're 50. What's that?
Yeah, sorry, go ahead. I'm off on a tangent, guys. Sorry.
No, I just, we love hearing about your tripping days. Which I'm sure was like weeks ago.
It was just last year, but he was last year.
Yeah.
Which I mean,
so we haven't
Spider-Man movie. Yep. Man, sorry. Go ahead.
No,
sorry.
I was going to say, we haven't mentioned the Oracle, the product of incest. I mean, this cult is really fucked up.
They're disgusting. Oh, yeah. Let me talk about that.
Unclouded. Unclouded.
As a product of incest myself, let me talk about
seems wrong.
No, but to me, that's where I thought these people, this is all bullshit. They're just taking whatever ramblings this special needs kid is writing, and they're making that their gospel in these books that it looked, was that whole room filled with older versions of the book? And they just kept adding to it?
I love how all the illustrations basically showed what was going
to happen. That tapestry.
I didn't need the girl cutting her pubes, and you know that they showed every stage. But even you saw the bear earlier, the painting of the bear in her apartment, right? I think it was
was that the bear with the fire? I know there was a photo. There's a bear with the girl.
I think that's in her apartment,
in the one the apartment where she was sleeping on the couch. Yeah, that might have been her apartment. There's another shot of her picture on that when her parents are dead in bed. There's the picture of her.
So disturbing that is.
And it's covered with flowers, like the May Queen's head.
Oh yeah,
head dressing.
Those shots at the end. So that it does
everything
such
with
a good
the sister
job,
is
you know,
disturbing.
It really is. So most horror movies, you know, they go to, you know, teens, they build it up, right? They build up the suspense. Everybody's having fun right away. This right away is just such a traumatic event. And everybody knows that anxiety when someone's not answering you and, you know, she's just in despair.
But
that happens. It's just so crazy.
That shot of pushing through her out to the snowy window and then the credits start, just so it was like
introduction. Cold open.
Here's the movie, get ready to be
the one-er. I think it was kind of a one-er, right? But then you get into the snow.
There was a lot of those, a lot of steady cam.
The rest is going to be in spring. So when we announced this movie to Dave, he was very confused that we were doing a Midsommar movie in the fall.
I did.
And I still didn't know a horror movie.
I didn't know we were watching it until the day I watched it.
We just told you, you'll be freaked out, and it's from the guy who did Hereditary. No,
Dave, what was your favorite thing about this?
What would you say? My favorite part of this movie was probably
the whole favorite aspect
not,
of it.
Not the sex scene. I think the ending was probably the best. Because it did come full circle. It starts a completely one way, And then mm-hmm. it ends a completely fucking different way. Where yeah. she a point other she had now as a family again. Where she lost everything and now she seems like she's gaining something back. Mm-hmm. So I think that was my favorite part of the movie.
As horrific as everything was to, you know, happening to them, these guys were all getting their comeuppance, so it wasn't really like you felt bad for them. You only felt bad for Danny, really. You were only worried about her.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think my favorite part definitely is definitely the part when Danny actually becomes the May Queen, because I feel like that's kind of the turning point in the movie where it's clear that, you know, Christian is going, everyone else is dead. Christian's going to be completely abandoned, because right before that festival day, some of the elders are grilling him in the village, like, you know, where's Josh? Where's Mark? Where is like the sacred book? Because Josh was really into the sacred book. But, you know, that whole part when she becomes the May Queen and kind of about what you guys were saying earlier, like, I think it was, you know, that was predetermined that they knew Danny was going to be the new May Queen. You know, she was the most vulnerable. She was the one that didn't have any family or anything like that. And then kind of when she becomes that point,
just like the election.
But when it gets to that point where she becomes the May Queen, that's kind of the first time in the movie where it looks like she's truly happy.
She looks like she's having fun.
Yep, that's like the first time where it looks like she's truly happy. But, you know, the messed up part is where she's truly happy is she's with this pagan cult, you know, that's doing all these horrific practices and all these sacrifices on presumably innocent people, maybe not by their standards innocent people, but innocent people. But yeah, when she's first happier, the scene when they're dancing and she starts randomly talking to that girl in Swedish, like during the dance.
Yeah. Oh yeah, that's pretty great.
It's like at that moment, you know, you kind of just know that like it's pretty much over for everybody else, and this is where she's.
Well, you can see it. You can see where her boyfriend was sitting on the sidelines, and they were trying to give him some kind of drink, and he didn't want to take it because he knew there was something in it. But
so, did you notice? I don't know if that guy has red hair in real life, but did you notice he? He's kind of a redhead in the movie, at least, right? And I'm like, is that why they make him a perfect match for this girl?
I thought you were going to make a pube comment, but okay.
No. I was not going to make a pube comment. Speaking of Mikey's favorite part, besides the sex scene, Mike, what did you most like?
I liked how they're teaching the young kids how to, you know, gut the bear so they could take the
bear.
Thought that he's standing, he's in the chair and he can't do a thing about it. He's just kind of looking like, what the hell's going on?
Yeah,
I think
that is
the bear and that final smile.
Disturbing too, obviously. It's you know, as much as you don't like him, you like imagine being paralyzed
He's also drugged. You know, a lot.
Yes, that's what I'm. He's drugged. He's drugged. He can't speak or talk. He can't speak or talk. He can't move or talk. Hold on. But you know what part I loved is when they even just arrive at the what is it called again? The commune? I forget the hedug. You know what I'm talking about.
It's a Swedish word. Yeah.
Yeah. When they're all standing there. But when they do the overhead and they arrive there and it's like all the fanfare, it's like, you know, but I mean, it was like all happy, but you knew it was like, oh, this is going to be, I mean,
they were
aside
happy that
from
they're
that,
not the ones dying.
Yeah. Aside, you knew something, this is going to be a messed up place. And then obviously I love the pantless, Ulf with Mark's skin face.
Of course.
And I think he was wearing his skin legs too. You see like a little line on his legs. I studied that picture. So just a great, horrific, disturbing movie.
Absolutely. A perfect beginning. Well, no, I guess you could still say Sixth Sense.
Shut the fuck up with the perfect beginning. We already did the perfect
October.
Beginning.
Well, now it's October.
Sixth Sense was the perfect
starting point for Halloween. Absolutely.
Oh, God.
It was.
We talked about...
And I didn't understand.
I don't know what his deal is, Dave.
Was your brother shitting on Sixth Sense? Yeah, Greg, was he shitting on him, or was he agreeing with Mikey and I? I don't understand.
He was agreeing
that.
With you two.
Oh, yeah, good. I thought so. Okay, perfect. Good job, Greg.
We didn't understand. Now we're happy now. before we talk about what's next, are there any other thoughts you want to get out about Midsommar.
Mikey, when you watched your brother burning your dog, right, the first time,
yes,
what did you think? What was going on in your head when you first realized this is going on in my family? Like, what was
my
first
thought? Was, wow, my dog is hairy everywhere.
Your second thought was, why was my dad?
It didn't slow my brother down a bit. What?
I think, go ahead.
I like how you try.
See, this is the part where I just sit back and drink.
Yeah, you're not going to creep me.
Just mute yourself. Just sit back, relax.
This is the perfect movie for me to unleash the fact that your parents are not in a sex cult. Your parents are not pornographers. Your parents are not incestuous. Well, but we like to lean into
pornographers.
His fetish is my parents. He wants them so bad, and they just turn him down.
Mike, you should reach out to Ari Aster. You might have a film idea here.
I know. It's with this creep right there.
This sounds right up his alley.
Now.
Oh, side note. I still have not seen Beau is Afraid.
Oh, that's what I wanted to
Jack,
ask.
Jack, did you end up ever watching it. That?
I have not seen Beau is Afraid yet, no.
He is kind of getting turned off on the description. What?
What was the Thanksgiving horror movie? What's it called?
Oh, fucking idiot. We're talking about Ari Aster. Now, he is working on another movie. Shut up, Dave. He's working on another movie with Joaquin, a Western, I think.
Is he? I can't wait. He supposedly has like 11 scripts.
Oh, excellent.
I can't wait for the Joker 2 to come out.
Yes, that's another movie with...
That's got nothing to do with Ari Aster, but thank you.
Now, I like the Tin Man.
Shut up. Now, listen. Dave talks about really, really, he's really into my family. But next time, we're going to be talking about another family. Oh, David, do you know what we're doing next time?
The Adams Family?
You idiot. From 1974, celebrating...
That would be the end of 50th, this podcast. Sorry, Mike.
Celebrating its 50th anniversary, a little art house film, the Tobey Hooper classic, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. We talked about this on tech. Dave's he's looking like completely surprised, like he hasn't seen this for the first time.
He's excited.
We haven't decided.
I've seen the movie. It's so unsettling.
That's why we're watching.
Ugh. Have you seen that, Jack?
I swear you brought it up.
I have seen bits and pieces of it, but I have not seen it start to end. I spent most of my summer, over the summer, some of the people that I worked with were really behind on their movie culture. So I just had to show them, you know, like some Boston classics like The Town, Good Will Hunting, The Departed. Nice. So
we've
done all three of those.
Yes. I listened to your episode on The Departed.
Excellent.
Good Will Hunting, great. I love the crying scene. Oh, that was one of the best.
We heard
it. Yeah.
What else do you like, Dave?
The worst acting I think in that movie was that scene.
Get out of here.
It's okay. It's okay.
Get out of here.
It's not your fault. It's not your fault. No, it's not your fault. You keep telling yourself that.
Nobody likes you. But I think, do we have any parting words left on Midsommar? Then
I think that was it. I think that's the perfect movie to not start Halloween season, but to continue.
Keep it going. Yeah.
Oh, I want to thank Jack for joining us. Hopefully we didn't scare him away where he wouldn't have.
It's good job, buddy.
You'll have to come back.
Hey.
Thank you, Jack.
Is there
anything like you want to promote? Anything, can you be found online or? If not, that's fine too.
I'm not really. I'm not really online too much.
Your life's about to change.
Mikey, what the hell are you trying to do with this kid? What's wrong with you?
I'm giving free promotions.
He's such a fucking...
I'm not asking him to send me pictures to my specific email that I'll send. I'm not going to text him later my email address.
Wow. What
this took a turn.
I'm not grooming anybody.
Terrible, Mikey.
How about you, PD?
I'm so sorry, Jack. Dave, are you David? David, can we find you at any of P. Diddy's freakouts? And how much baby oil do you have in your house right now?
I have the appropriate amount of baby oil in my house.
And you are sitting in a vibrating chair. That's
Costco,
sure.
Right? Yeah, get that at Costco.
Man. Great.
By the case,
Christopher, any parting words from you?
Nothing. No parting words. Thank you, gentlemen. Thanks, Jack.
Yes,
it was a good time.
Real quick, you can find the show. Find
my
movies.
Pleasure.
Find _movies on Twitter, find movies, find spirits on Instagram, and at fans.experts.com. My dog will not stop.
You'll find Mikey in jail soon enough, everyone. Don't worry about that. Soon enough, you'll be in jail. fraud and atrocities.
All right, that's it. It's done. We're done. I hate you.
We talk about great movies while drinking. We talk about great movies while drinking. Yeah, we talk about great movies while drinking. And we feel fine.
Maybe that Ozempic seems to be working with you, huh? Just what? Not shrinking your head down. Yeah, Ozempic seems to be working. Just not shrinking your head.
Yeah. Take off
your like fucking toothpick.
Is the testosterone shots working for you? Pop off that shirt and let's show everyone what's going on.
My chest is fucking big. I'm
sure it is.
Oh, I don't need testosterone. That's the way you saw it. Yeah, I don't need it.
Oh, good. Good.
My testosterone.
So which doctor you went to told you you're fine?
No, the fucking blood work that I actually took said I have high testosterone for a fucking 50-year-old man.
Wow.
Can we get this show on the road?
Jack, I apologize that you had to be part of this.
Don't respond to anything he sends you, please.
I apologize to your parents. I apologize.
I will avoid any texts from unsolicited numbers.
This is good. Good move, smart man. This is going to be heavily edited.
This is why. This is why I wasn't allowed to be on Xbox Live as a child, because people like it. Fab's not experts.